Welcome to this live recording of Help Me Teach the Bible. I'm Nancy Guthrie. And today my guest on Help Me Teach the Bible is the Reverend Dr. Tim Keller. Tim, thank you for being here with us. Thank you for helping us teach the Bible.
I haven't done it yet.
Well, we're counting on you to do it.
Thank you in advance.
You probably know this already, but Tim Keller is the senior pastor of Redeemer Presbyterian Church in Manhattan, New York, and recently announced he'll be stepping down from being senior pastor on July 1. In order, you made it very clear you don't intend to retire.
Right.
I was just wondering, did you feel like you had to say that because did John Piper threaten you that if you said you're going to retire, and if he ever saw pictures posted on Facebook of you and Kathy gathering seashells, that he would unfriend you?
No. Had nothing to do with him.
So you're not going to retire, but you want to continue investing yourself in mentoring leaders.
Right.
Do evangelism, church planting.
Right. And actually spend more time teaching people to teach the Bible than teaching the Bible. I think that's the season of my life.
Well, then it's great you're here today. I'm glad I could kick off your new
endeavor. I was trying to play right into what we're doing.
Fabulous. You're also a co-founder and president of the Gospel Coalition. Mm. So we thank you for what you and Don Carson and others have done to build this organization, don't we? Thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, I wonder if you could start by just talking to us a little bit about how you developed personally as someone who teaches the Bible. Can you remember back to maybe sitting under teaching and beginning to think, I'd like to do that?
Yes.
What brought that about?
I don't remember exactly. I do think, look, if you are watching a great figure skater, you go, wow, that's great. But a few people, and by the way, I wasn't one of them, a few people say, I'd like to do that. Mm-hmm. Most of the rest of us just love it. So, in other words, we don't say, oh, I want to do that. So when you watch something that you not only appreciate, but then you say, boy, I wouldn't mind doing that myself, then that's a calling. I mean, and even at the level of anybody, not just a Christian, thing, even at a certain level, I think that's how people find their talents, is they see someone else exercising a talent, and they, even though they feel like, I don't know that I could do that, you sense a desire to do it. And most other people just receive the talent, and they don't have that feeling. So I don't remember exactly. I don't have it'd be nice to give you a dramatic memory of a time, but I just remember when I first experienced great Bible teaching, I did sense, boy, that would be a great thing to do. I don't think there was one dramatic moment.
Can you remember the first time you got up in front of people with your Bible open and taught?
Yes, I did. It was in my little church in Emmaus, Pennsylvania, and it wasn't terribly good, but I did do it, and I wanted to do it. Yeah, when I was about 19, I think.
So then what course did it take for you to learn to get better? Were there certain models you listened to and you thought, okay, I want to figure out how to do that?
Yeah. Well, I became a Christian through InterVarsity Christian Fellowship in the late 60s. And most of the people you read in those days, actually, Mark Knoll, who's a church historian, said that if you became a Christian in America in the 60s, and you were college educated, generally the people that you would be reading would be British people. So you were reading John Stott or David Martin Lloyd Jones or J.I. Packer or F.F. Bruce or I. Howard Marshall or people like that. So I was exposed almost immediately to John Stott, and he was the first person I ever saw just open. I'd been at church, so I'd heard sermons, but he opened the Bible. He just explained the Bible. When you were done, you looked at it and said, why didn't I see it before? But now that he explained it, I can't not see it. So that's a way of saying that was in the text, I just didn't see it. So that, he was the gold standard for me, and he was really the first example and my first model and an attractive model to me.
Well, I don't want to presume, but I presume this was before the internet.
Well, yeah.
All right. I mean, because we
as
have
a matter
much...
of fact, I was I had most of my life before the internet. Just to let you know, not just half my life or part of my life, but most of my life.
I mean, the truth is, we have today. We can choose models mm-hmm. On another continent more
right.
easily than them. So, how did you get exposed to John Stott in that way?
Well, we had these things called books back then.
Okay.
Nancy.
But you didn't hear, then you weren't hearing him teaching.
No.
You're talking about what
no.
he did in books.
No, I was actually impressed. The books, even his books, would open a text of the past. When I heard him teach, it was just like the book.
Okay.
So, but I did hear him teach a couple times, and he was, that was great as well. But actually, I was exposed to the teaching through writing.
So, you went to college.
Yeah.
Intending to be in ministry?
No. I became a Christian in college. I went, like a lot of folks, I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do when I went to college. So.
And then to Gordon Conwell after that?
Yeah, I did go right away. So I did get into the ministry. I was still 24 when I took a church, and the church I had a Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Service. Each one was a different Bible exposition.
Wow.
So at the age of 24, I took a church of about 70 to 100 people, and it was my job to come up with 3 Bible expositions a week.
Trial by fire.
Well, I remember I was sat down, and I remember in seminary, I did learn to write a sermon, but it took me like 2 weeks to write a sermon.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, it takes me 2 weeks to write a sermon, and I have 3 sermons a week to write. And then I said, the math isn't working.
So if we had a recording or a video, because let's talk a little bit about both content and delivery. If we had a recording or a video of those early sermons, what would we see that's different than the way you teach or preach now?
The thing that's the same, and actually we didn't, I skipped over this. There was a woman who was an InterVarsity Christian Fellowship staff worker, one of the first IVCF national staff workers. Her name was Barbara Boyd. And Barbara Boyd had been trained at Biblical Seminary in New York, which is no more, especially by a man named Robert Trina. And she had learned a way of doing inductive Bible study. And when I became a Christian, she was running what she called Bible and Life conferences. And one of the conferences, it was called the Level 2 Conference, you basically learn how to do an inductive study of a passage and outline it, break it into parts, find the laws of composition, ask questions of the laws of composition that you observed, come up with application, and basically do a Bible study. And it was a terrific, it was just tremendous. It enabled me to lead Bible studies when I was still a student. When I first got into the ministry, it meant that I could actually write a sermon by sitting down and just doing my inductive Bible study, because you could outline the text, which could be your outline of your message. You asked questions to find out its basic interpretive principle, what was going on in the text. You came up with application. So my first sermons would have just been almost just presenting my Bible study
mm-hmm.
with checking it with commentaries to make sure I wasn't off. But those early sermons were not very Christ-centered in the sense that I didn't yet have a good idea that I had to make sure I put each text into the context of the whole Bible, which of course always points to Jesus. So my early sermons wouldn't have had that. But in other ways, they would be very similar.
Well, you're one of the people that really helped me learn how or perhaps to see the void in my own teaching of what exactly you're talking about in terms of putting Christ in the center and seeing that passage in the whole of the story of the Bible. So how did you come to, you helped me with that. Who helped you?
Well, in seminary, I learned it. I mean, I was taught it by, even though he wasn't at the Gordon Conwell Seminary, Edmund Clowney, the president of Westminster Seminary, I remember he came to Gordon and did a series of lectures. It was an annual lectureship, and he came and preached on how you preach Christ from the Old Testament, the New Testament, the wisdom literature, the Psalms, the prophets. It was fascinating, and I actually wrote it down, and I learned it well enough to do well in the course. But it was years before I really connected it. So often you think you know something, and you actually it doesn't really affect the way in which you do your work. So I don't know where exactly or what pushed me, but eventually it dawned on me I was not preaching the way I knew I was supposed to. It was very much a process. I don't think there was, again, there wasn't a dramatic turning place. But I actually learned to do it, but as time went on. Well, another thing that happened was, okay, my wife, Kathy, would say that one time she said, you know, she says, your sermons are really good teaching, but it doesn't seem to, it doesn't soar till you get to, sometimes you get at the end and you show how Jesus is really what this passage is about. So you might be talking about parents and children and honoring your parents and raising your children. Then suddenly, if you actually bring in the fact that only through Jesus Christ do you really become, Jesus Christ, your true brother, enabled you to get into the family of God. In other words, when you get to Jesus, suddenly it becomes, she says, it soars. She used to say it also is like getting the rabbit out of the hat. You know, you're telling us to do this, and you really don't quite know how we're going to do it. And suddenly, you bring in Jesus, show how the text is actually pointing to him, and faith in him is the only way to get there. But that didn't happen that often. But when it did happen, she said, those sermons were, they just take you to heaven. The rest are very informative, but those sermons really take you to heaven. And when she started telling me about that, I kept saying, why am I not doing that every week? So it was a combination of remembering what I had learned in seminary, Kathy pressing me a bit on, why don't you do that every week, and eventually getting there. Now, I mean, at least since I've been at Redeemer, for example, that's always been the case.
When we think about Tim Keller's style of teaching or preaching, one thing you really model is anticipating objections.
Okay.
And I think all of us who teach want to be able to do that. Can you give us some help in both how to anticipate what objections might be and how to work it in? Because we're working there on the text, and our goal is to illumine the text, and we've got far more material from what we've discovered in the text than we have time to present anyway. So give us some pointers on how to do that. Or maybe before that, make a case for us why we should.
Well, you have to answer the questions people are asking. See, when you sit down with a text, actually, the reason why you can come back to that text 5 years later, 10 years later, 15 years later, the rest of your life, and always see something new, but not be reading things in, but actually seeing things that you didn't see before. The reason that can happen your whole life is because you actually come with different questions. Ed Clowney once said, he says, the Bible, your biblical text gives you an answer to every question you bring to it. But people come with different questions. It's one of the reasons why, actually, an older person or a suffering person or a male or a female or a single person or a married person, they actually have somewhat different questions in their head when they come to the text, and therefore they actually will see things that are there that somebody else with different questions may not see. So the key is, if you want to be interesting, you need to be coming to the text with the questions of the people you're trying to teach it to, which means you gotta talk a lot to them. The whole way you deal with objections is you talk to people, and so you hear about their objections, you hear about their problems, their questions. Then when you sit down with the text, you've got them in your head. And you just naturally will produce Bible teaching that connects with those questions and that actually, in many cases, anticipates the objections. And so as long as you're not, you know, on a mountain or in an ivory tower somewhere, if you're actually talking with the people that you're teaching all the time, your teaching is going to become very life-related. But if you're not talking to people, in other words, if you're coming with the questions in your heart but not on their hearts, it's going to be uninteresting.
Well, besides talking to people, one thing that strikes me about you, and it really did when I was reading your book on preaching, you have a section in here about how to use literature, writing, ideas from the culture and bring it into your teaching. And when I read that, I was like, I'd like to do that, but I'm simply not that well read. I mean, I wrote in my margin. Oh, here's what I wrote. How do you find these things? See it?
Yeah. Well, actually, for example.
How do you find these things?
Your handwriting's pretty good.
Thank you.
Well, it's still not as important as talking to people.
Okay.
Number one, it's not quite as important as, in some ways, the reading is a bit of a shortcut, because I'm, like, if I read an angry atheist and what they think of the church or something like that, that's a little, in some ways, that's a little easier than finding an angry atheist and sitting down and listening. So it's a shortcut, but it still helps because I've got that person's concerns in my head as I'm studying my text. So all I can say is reading is just an extension of the talking. It's just another way of talking to people that you might not meet otherwise. Now, how do you find all those things? Read what you can. And then, what I do is, I'm a good reader, yes, and maybe better than others, but that's not a virtue. It's just something I'm good at. But what I actually will do is, I always read the footnotes or the endnotes, and to see, if I'm reading a book, I always want to see what books were probably behind that book. Because most of us who write books generally are not perfectly original. In general, we're kind of riffing on and developing one or two other books on that subject that have most shaped us. So go find that book. You can always find it. There's some references to it. And then go read that. And that's how I learn to read the next thing. The other thing is, read. One of the reasons why I always read the editorial page of the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal is because one is sort of center left, one is sort of center right. And that way I can really hear how the whole nation thinks.
Do you know what I'm thinking right now?
What's that?
I don't know, I'm just thinking.
No, I mean, they are very different. And that's the point, is that you expose yourself to differences. You won't be a good Bible teacher if you only read. If you do, the social media, the Facebook thing, Everything takes you to other things you already want to read. You know,
it's made to do that.
It's made to reinforce the beliefs you already have. If you're going to be a good Bible teacher, you've got to break out of that, and you've got to read people in the parts of the internet that you know, where people, the fever swamps that you really don't like. You've got to read those folks a lot, sympathetically. So the reading does help you talk to a lot of different people. Ultimately, it just means, who are you talking to? That'll affect how you read the text and then teach the text.
Most of us have seen you operate most in a preaching situation.
Right.
How would we experience you differently in a teaching situation? If you were leading a small group or teaching a Sunday school kind of class at your church, would there be something different about the way you approach that?
Well, the purpose of a sermon is worship. I'm trying to get people to worship. And the purpose of a lecture or a teaching is really informing the mind. It's not quite, you gotta be careful, because a good sermon should have a lot of teaching in it, and good teaching should apply to the heart and to the life. But in teaching, I can make more points. In sermons, I shouldn't make as many points, because what I should be doing is I should be taking fewer points, which I use through things like exegesis and what's the text say. So I'm doing teaching to establish the point, but then I should make fewer points, and I should just drill it in and lift it up and expand on it until I'm getting people's hearts engaged and lives and they're starting to pray. So I should make fewer points, and I should do much more application and work on the heart. Whereas I think in my teaching, I can make more points. Mm-hmm. And I certainly want to have an application to it, but I'm not really trying to create an experience of worship at all. I'm not trying to trigger that. I'm actually just simply trying to inform the mind.
Is there more back and forth?
In a
teaching situation?
Yes, it should be. Should be. Well, now, by the way, even in white churches, there's a back and forth between the preacher and the audience. In non-white churches, there's a lot of back and forth. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, even in a white church, you can't. The people are communicating with you, but they're doing it in sign language. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't open their mouths. But you mm-hmm. can see whether they're moved, mm-hmm. whether they're crying, whether they're bored. Mm-hmm. You can see, and they're telling you. Mm-hmm. And so there's some. But by and large, in teaching, it's far better if there's a lot of interaction. Oh, my mm-hmm. goodness, far better. Mm-hmm. That's
Absolutely.
Where you want. So more points and more interaction would be a teaching, and fewer points and less interaction in sermon.
Here's something you wrote in your book on preaching. It says, the moment you open your mouth, many things, your cadence, accent, vocabulary, illustrations, mm-hmm. ways of reasoning, the way you express emotions mm-hmm. make you culturally more accessible to some people, force others to stretch and work harder to understand or even pay attention to you.
Right.
No one can present a culture-free formulation of biblical truth.
Yeah.
So all of us know we can do a lot of work preparing our teaching, but then comes that moment when we're trying to communicate it. So you also observe a lot of teachers and preachers over the years. So
yeah.
What do you see as very common stumbling blocks to our ability to get across what's in God's Word in our delivery, in our presentation?
Well, now, I mean, like, cross-culturally, you mean, or?
No, I just think, what are real typical problems that you think, wow, I'd like to pull this person aside and tell them this
oh.
is really hindering the ability of everybody to get what they're trying to say. They really get their topic, but it's not
yeah.
getting across.
Okay, I'll give you five things. Is that enough?
Okay, I'm ready.
All right. One is the teachers very often aren't, they're not clear.
Yes.
In the sense of you're not really sure what they're getting at. You need to be able to say, I'm.
This is what you do. I'm going to tell you this and this and this.
Yeah, or at least people should at least know. You don't necessarily have to tell them ahead of time, but they've got to see that there are stages on a journey and that they're moving.
A progression that's
yeah,
understandable.
You don't want if people feel like you said that before, you're kind of going around in circles. What are you getting at? Where are we going? That's what I mean. A clear pathway is what I meant. So people feel like I'm making progress. You're building a case, you're unfolding a truth that I know where I'm going. So mm-hmm. sometimes people feel like it's just, you're going around in circles. So there's a clear pathway, or a lack of a clear pathway would be one problem. Second is, this is interesting. One would be it's not practical. A second would be that sometimes the teaching is too much it's too much about, there sometimes is a little bit of a fetish about biblical knowledge. I just want to know it because it's in the Bible. So what were the names of the two magicians that opposed Moses before the face of Pharaoh, Jannes and Jambres? And do you know where they're mentioned? In the book of Jude. So I know that. And you didn't.
I didn't.
You didn't know that. Okay. And you know what? So what? So okay. what? Who cares? But there's sometimes a tendency with Bible teachers to feel like just to letting you know some fact about the Bible means we're more spiritual because we know that fact. No. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to God, but the things that are revealed that you may do all the works of the law, which means God never tells you something just to be believed. He does not waste any part of the Bible on things just to be believed. There are always things that should affect how you live. And so there is sometimes it's just not very practical. It's like we know this stuff, and now we know this stuff. Isn't it great that we know this stuff about the Bible? I want to know how it helps me live. So there's a lack of clear pathway. Secondly, there's a lack of practical application. Here's the thirdly. Sometimes it's not very persuasive. A lot of Bible teachers just know how to assert. It's partly social media does that. People don't argue. They assert. They just say, this is the way it is. Persuasion, the essence of persuasion is to take something somebody already believes and then use that against them to say, well, if you believe that, and I believe that too, why don't you believe this? Not just say, why don't you believe this? Because then you say, I believe this, you don't believe this, you're wrong. That's not persuasive, that's an assertion, that's not an argument. An argument is when you say, you believe this and I believe this too, then if you believe this, well, why don't you believe this? And very often Bible teachers aren't persuasive. So there's not a clear pathway. Sometimes I say, what's wrong? No clear pathway, not practical, not persuasive. Here's one more. I said I was going to give you five, but it feels like I'm going on a long time. The fourth one is not vivid. Now, preachers work at this. Very often Bible teachers do not work at this, but they should. What you want to do is you want to connect the proposition to sensory language, so you should use illustrations as much as you can. Jonathan Edwards says, your good deeds cannot keep you out of hell. And in other words, you can't save yourself. So he says, your good deeds cannot keep you out of hell. Okay, that's a true proposition. But then he says, any more than a spider web can stop a falling rock. And when he says that, he's connecting a propositional truth to an actual sensory experience you've had, which is spider webs are so absolutely frail and fragile and flimsy that they can't stop a thing. If a rock comes and hits a spider web, it does not slow the rock down. It's not like the rock doesn't go like this and go through, it just goes, and it's his way of saying your good deeds are like, they're like a spider web, they're like nothing. And what he did there was he connected an abstract proposition with a sensory experience, and it grabs you. Mm-hmm. It not only explains the proposition more, I mean, it actually is giving you, it's even, in a sense, enhancing your understanding of the truth, but it also affects you. Mm-hmm. And I do think Bible teachers don't put enough thought into illustrations. I know preachers are always looking for metaphors and illustrations so that they are not teaching a lot of abstraction, but I think Bible teachers have to be careful about that. So Bible teachers very often aren't vivid enough, they're not persuasive enough, they're not practical enough, and they don't show a clear pathway through. So that's all we'll go.
Helpful.
There's
Thank
always
you.
More things you do wrong, but
probably so.
Yeah, not you personally.
Well, this probably is a good time to mention that the very first time I ever left my house and went out to speak somewhere, do you know who was standing in the back of the room?
No, who?
In 2002.
2002, was it me?
It was you.
Okay, so sorry.
And afterwards, I think I asked for some input. You seemed somewhat hesitant to give it, because I got the feeling you felt it would crush me. So that was probably true. But anyway, it was very intimidating, just let me say.
Okay.
Anyway.
So and you brought me here to tell me this?
Yes.
Couldn't you have told me this somewhere else, like on the phone or
yes.
email or something like that?
So you're one of the only people I've heard talk extensively about meditation. Heard you talk about your investment, in a sense, of meditating on Scripture.
Yeah.
Where did that come from, and how do you think it impacts your word ministry?
Oh, a lot. By the way, Peter Adam, who's already spoken here, Australian brother, has written a book. In fact, for whatever reason, his books aren't very well known in the States, but he wrote a book on meditation called Hearing God's Word, which is just terrific, and shows how important in the Reformed tradition, meditation is, whenever you hear the word meditation, you almost immediately think of mysticism. There actually is a mystical side to the Reformed tradition too, but it's all about meditating on God's word, not meditating on your hand, not trying to do Eastern meditation where you are trying to suppress rational thought or anything like that. It's meditating on the word. So it's very, in the Reformed tradition, that is how our spirituality works. But for preaching and teaching, it means that if you know how to meditate, you pretty much have your Bible study. Like, for example, one of the things I often notice with Dr. David Martin Lloyd-Jones, I'm not suggesting you do this, by the way, but Dr. Lloyd-Jones very often could preach whole texts, whole sermons on three words or four words. He crawls through the book of Romans, if you ever read those things. He did do three sermons on but now. Was it, but now, a righteousness is revealed apart from the law. He just, three sermons on but now. But I realized after a while reading those things that he actually was basically, he knew how to meditate to get so much out of a few words, and that's why he was able to teach the way he was doing. Let me give you an example. Barbara Boyd taught us this, the person who taught me how to teach the Bible. She says, take a verse and meditate on it this way. Take the one word of the verse out and imagine what happens if you take that word out, which helps you see the work that word is doing in the meaning of the sentence, and shows you, in a sense, an aspect of its teaching. So what she had us do was work on Mark chapter 1, verse 17. Jesus said, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. So follow me. Follow me and I will. Follow me and I will make you to become, not just make you, but make you to become fishers of men. Now, if you take each of those and say, it's not just saying follow that, follow me. It's not just saying learn from me, it's saying follow me. It's not just saying follow me, it's saying follow me and, which is a promise. Follow me and I, with Jesus personally, and I will. It's unconditional. Make you to become, it's a process. And what we did was you work through it, and if you actually drop one word out and say, well, how does that change the meaning? That's meditation. There's other ways to do meditation, but you're meditating until you see 10, 12, 15 things that the text is teaching because you have really pondered every word and what it brings to the sentence. And so meditation, if you learn how to do it, you have no end of material. Mm-hmm. It almost essentially gives you your message, gives you your teaching.
Wow, that's really helpful.
Okay.
Thank you. Everyone gets criticized at some point or another, and you're a very public person, so that means you experience public criticism. Mm-hmm. But all of us, in the context in which we are, in our churches or organizations where we're teaching the Bible, occasionally somebody's going to criticize us, and maybe it's personal criticism, maybe it's criticism of a content or our style or whatever. So if someone was maybe a teacher of a small group or leader of a small group in your church, and they came to you and they said, you know, I'm receiving this criticism and I'm not sure how to deal with it, what would you tell them?
Well, it depends on who it's from, of course. I mean, if there's people in your small group that are criticizing you, you need to find out, how deep is the division? Sometimes a person has almost a completely different approach to Christianity, and you're never going, and you're just you're the latest example of what they don't like. Mm-hmm. You know, an example, I'm not trying to pick on anything. You know, there's the charismatic ministry and non-charismatic ministry can be pretty different. Reformed ministry and non-reformed, I mean, there's a number of different kinds, there's a lot of different kinds of Christianity out there. So if somebody actually really wishes the church that you're in was a different kind of church, mm-hmm. really wishes the church was more charismatic or more liturgical or less liturgical or more this or more that, they just might be, you just might be representing the kind of Christianity they don't like. Mm-hmm. And actually in that case, which happens to me a lot, by the way, because the more, you know, higher profile you are, you write books, you get higher profile, and people, one of the things I've had to learn is don't take it personally, because I just represent something they don't like and they're using me as an excuse to air their opinion. And I just happen to be there. And that can even be true for a small group leader or a Bible teacher, that the person who's always criticizing is just criticizing the kind of Christianity you represent. Second possibility is maybe you actually should listen to the criticism because maybe it's true. Maybe you're intemperate, or maybe you don't, you're not being careful, or maybe you're not being circumspect enough. So that's what's so bad about this question of criticism. One is, you might say, it's just not personal, don't worry about it. Mm-hmm. In fact, you could never satisfy that person, because they really need a different kind of Christianity, a different kind of church, I mean. Mm-hmm. Secondly, you need to listen very hard to it, because actually the person is pointing out that you are actually not being circumspect or careful or something like that. The third But the third thing is you really do have to work on your heart, because mm-hmm. criticism bothers us more than
Stings.
It should. Always bothers us more than it should, because we tend to identify our ministry with our, it becomes our identity. Mm-hmm. And you can say, oh, I'm loved by Jesus and I'm accepted by him. But what happens is if you get a little proud of the fact that you're a Bible teacher, if you just get a little proud of that, and somebody comes along and points out where you're not being a good Bible teacher, it just, very often you melt down, and it's not all their fault. It's that you have, you believe, you put your identity in Christ, but you also put too much of your identity in your ministry. So that's what I mean by saying sometimes you ought to look at yourself and say, I have a spiritual problem. Sometimes you ought to look at your teaching and say, I do need to make some changes. And sometimes you'll look at the person and say, I'm just the occasion for this person's mm-hmm. unhappiness, and I really can't make that person happy, and I shouldn't try. Mm-hmm. And those are very different situations. So you have to be careful not just to have a, you know, this is what you do with criticism. Or
mm-hmm. You and I have a mutual friend, Charles McGowan.
Yeah.
And I remember one time when David and I were leading a Sunday school class and we were getting criticism, and I went to him with this question, and his answer was very similar to yours. He added one thing. He added, and then don't quit.
Yeah.
Which I thought was good.
In every one of those cases, you shouldn't quit. That's right. If you just say, oh, I don't want to be there, I don't want to be subject to that.
Yeah, if I'm going to be criticized, then don't just.
That's right.
Yeah. Kind of going along with that, what you were talking about, having your identity as a Bible teacher, we hear a lot of conversation, especially in our age of blogs and big events like this one and social media, the idea of a person developing a platform. And I think no matter where we are, and I mean, that can be in our small town, our medium-sized town, or, you know, nationwide, international, whatever, platform. Talk to us about your thoughts about that term, about the idea of that, especially in terms of our, what's been entrusted to us in terms of God's Word and being a person who wants to give out God's Word and not just put ourselves out there.
You know, it was about 3 years that I heard people talking about platforms before I figured out what it was. And for example, Nancy, you and I are actually on a real platform.
I know, that's true.
You know that?
I almost fell off, but yes. I am here. Okay.
Well, yes, you almost tripped on it, which shows that platforms are very dangerous things.
Yes, they are.
I think that you should give almost no thought to it at all. Now, maybe you need to come back.
Are you so super spiritual that you can do that?
Oh gosh, I know what you're. That's an understandable counter question, but I'm saying, why do you want a platform? In other words, if you're teaching the Bible in your church, for example, then you would like to increase the number of people you teach to. You hope your group grows or your class grows. That shows you're teaching well. There's nothing wrong with being encouraged by that. If you're a preacher, there's nothing wrong with wanting to see your church grow. People bring folks. Some people get converted. Some people have their lives changed. That's great. But beyond that, first of all, by the way, right now, for the last 3 or 4 years, as you alluded, I've been preparing to give my church, as it were, divide it into three. And give the church, as it were, not one successor, but three pastors. And they have, so for the last several years, my Redeemer has really been divided into three congregations, and you go to one of those congregations, and you get me 1 week, and you get your local pastor another week preaching, or the other pastors who are there. They report up to me for the time being. When I step out, there won't be somebody who comes into my place at all. In a certain sense, I have no successor. Which means at every one of these places I've been preaching for the last 3 or 4 years, I don't get to talk to the people anymore because I'm not pastoring them, really. They're being pastored by their pastor and their other pastors and their people. So it was sort of a transition, but I hate it because I hate teaching people that I don't know. And it seems to me that a lot of people are, in fact, I don't mind when you're writing a book, you know you're going to be ministering to people you don't know. Mm-hmm. But the book is more durable. It's going to be around for years. It's going to be, you hope people buy it. And so if you're talking about, do you try to get the publicity out so people will buy your book? Yeah. Do you do events to try to get people? Sure. But that's still, a platform is, I want to get as many people to hear me, but you don't know those people. I mean, to me, the only platform that matters is where you actually are in flesh and blood talking to people. Mm-hmm. And if you want to have a bigger venue, that's fine. But when it comes to media and blogs and, frankly, if you want to do that, fine, but to care about a platform where you're having a lot of people that you don't know read you and learn from you, I don't know why you want that anyway. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's creepy. I do want people to read the books, but it's a little creepy when people walk up to you and they seem to know you a lot better than you know them. Mm-hmm. You really want to embrace them, care about them, but it works. See, inside a church, that's all very organic and right. Outside, it feels artificial to me anyway. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I understand. I mean, your question, are you so super spiritual you don't need to care about that, is the kind of, you're right, you're channeling what other people would ask. But I would say, I don't know if that's spiritual or not. Now, I mean, you might want to ask me a counter question. I might be completely missing. Why? Who cares about a platform, basically?
A lot of people care about a platform. Yeah. A publisher cares about a platform.
Well, you should be more local. Whoever you are, you should be local church-based. That's what I think. Mm-hmm. I think you should be teaching, preaching, whatever you're doing, or local, you know, at least with flesh and blood people. And if then they say, write that up and let it go out there, fine. Or even if they say, let that grow into a, you know, have a website, sure, that's fine. Mm-hmm. But it actually should, the meat of what you're doing should be with real people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, thank you. I remember a number of years ago at a church, the youth pastors of the church recognized that one of the pastors at the church, every week his sermon sounded just like yours. Mm-hmm. He was tracking with your sermons, and the youth ministers were too, so they recognized it, that somebody was just taking your sermons and making them your own. And similarly, I was team teaching with a group one time, and one of the people, I had listened to your sermon on that particular one, even though it wasn't my week to teach, and that's what was presented. What do you say to someone who wants to listen to someone like you, hopefully a number of different, I've heard you say that before, listen to a number of people, not just one.
Right.
But why is that a problem? If I listen to Tim Keller or someone like him, and I just take that and make that my teaching.
Well, in the very, when you are starting in your development, your first one or two heroes, your first one or two people that you want to emulate, you asked me about my model, and in the beginning it was John Stott. Mm-hmm. It's almost impossible when you're starting out not to be pretty imitative. Mm-hmm. You probably heard me talk about the fact that if you, the only way to overcome that is to move on and to get other heroes. Mm-hmm. So, in a sense, if you could, I hope that if you cut me in half like a tree and counted, you'd see a number of different rings. There should be a lot of rings. There should be a George Whitfield ring and a John Stott ring and a lot of people who've influenced me. And then you develop your own voice. Mm-hmm. If there's one or two rings, then you really are going to be almost, the danger is plagiarism, where you're really just not
mimicking,
developing your own voice because mm-hmm. you don't have the time. Because you don't move on, you don't read other people, you don't listen to other people, you don't spend the time in the text yourself. Mm-hmm. And then if you're too busy, you're just going to sound like somebody else. And I mean, there were places in my, maybe you heard me say this before, there was one place where I had a sort of a George Whitfield phase, and I was reading lots of Whitfield sermons, mm-hmm. and he was so evangelistic and so passionate. He was the John Piper of his day. Mm-hmm. But at one point, Kathy actually said to me, you know, you need to move on. Your sound, and she says, there was a couple times in which I almost was afraid that you were going to say, methinks. You know, it was a couple places where she actually heard me sort of do something kind of, some word order that was a little archaic sounding, because I was really preaching so much out of a sermon that he had preached. So it's kind of natural, But you really do have to get past it, or you're being lazy, you're being unfair, you're using, you're really not giving, you're not feeding your people. Mm-hmm. So that's you do. So I'm not saying there's no seriousness to it at all. But I'm pretty understanding of it. At a certain phase in a life, it's hard to not be imitative.
Mm-hmm. But I think something you said there, when you do get into the text yourself. And the Holy Spirit meets you.
Right.
He gives you something that becomes authentically yours.
Yes. See, what I got from Barbara Boyd in Inductive Bible Study and InterVarsity was, before I go read the sermons on that text by my heroes, I get into the text myself. Mm-hmm. And usually, there's something, if I had gone to the heroes first, I probably wouldn't have found it. Mm-hmm. Because they're so brilliant that their insights would have overwhelmed what I found. And so that's why you have to do that yourself. Then go to commentaries. Then go to your sermon heroes and see how they preach the text. And then it'll be pretty good. And it won't sound just like anybody else but you.
Mm-hmm. Back in your preaching book, you have a section here where you're talking about the kind of language that we use. And you said language like this is used as a boundary marker, a way to tell others that you are in the tribe and they are not.
Yeah.
Insider language is frequently also an enabler of hypocrisy, yikes, as it offers a shortcut to sounding spiritual without actually having a heart filled with love and delight. So as teachers, how do we use this tribal or insider language? Can you give us an example of what you mean by that and what we might do instead?
Well, that's probably on the subtext, isn't it? Yeah, if you use too much theological jargon, you're talking about hermeneutics there's so many words you can use to, the danger is A, it shows off a little, it's a little bit like showing off. Mm-hmm. B, it's a little bit like saying to the outsider, you're going to have to, you're an outsider, and if you're really going to be with it, like the rest of us, you'll understand these terms. That's what mm-hmm. I mean by saying that. You want, as much as possible, you want to use accessible language. That's just as true for preachers who've got all the theological training. It's actually, in some ways, more of a danger for somebody who's been very theologically trained, because jargon is actually shorthand. I mean, the one good thing about these big words is they pack a lot in them. So it's like it's a way for experts to talk to each other without having to explain everything. But as a Bible teacher or a preacher, by definition, you're not talking to experts, so you shouldn't be trying to show off your expertise. You're not supposed to be setting up. There's a place in the book where I say that there's a thing called subtext, which is. Not what you're actually saying, but it's you read between the lines. And there are sermons I've heard, or Bible teachings I've heard. You could tell the people were actually just celebrating the fact that we're the wise people who know all the truth, mm-hmm. and nobody else does. Mm-hmm. I would actually say there's three subtexts. One subtext is we're the great people who are the few people in the world who really understand these great doctrines, and isn't it great that we're those people? That's one mm-hmm. subtext. In other words, that's the real purpose of your message. Mm-hmm. You might say, well, I'm here to expound 2 Samuel, but you're actually there to tell everybody, you know, that we're the wise people who understand our Reformed theology and everybody else is wrong. Mm-hmm. Another subtext is, don't you think I'm good? Don't you mm-hmm. think I really know my stuff? Mm-hmm. Don't you want to bring your friends? Don't you want to come back? Don't you want to give your money? That's the real, that's what you're really trying to say. And the right subtext should be, isn't Jesus great? Mm-hmm. And actually, it's really strange. A person can be almost saying the same thing on the same text, and yet because of the condition of the heart, those three different messages get through. That'd be depending on the condition of the heart.
So what encouragement would you offer to Bible teachers, especially they're just starting out and so enthusiastic about it, really have a sense of stewardship of God's word, yet perhaps week to week leave thinking like, I blew it. I didn't get this across, people were bored, or this is just too hard. Yeah. What encouragement would you offer to people in regard to persevering, but then also getting better at it?
I have felt the same way at times when you feel like you've spent a lot of time preparing and you've poured your heart out and you see almost no response, and you come home saying, what was that about? One is, you really should not be that sure that people aren't hearing it. You never, ever, ever know.
Have you been surprised a time or two?
All the time, and you should be too. You should know that when it doesn't look like you're getting much, you sometimes may feel, I didn't do a good job on that. I didn't remember where I was. I was looking at my notes. You come home feeling terrible, and then you get an email from somebody saying, that changed my life, I'll never forget that. Or 10 years later, somebody says, that changed my life, I never forgot that. And you remember, yeah, I kind of remember that. I didn't think it was a good day at all. So I've had enough of those experiences to know you can never be sure what God's doing. And that's the best way to encourage yourself. You can never be sure what's going on out there.
Mm-hmm. So. You say in here that understanding the biblical text, distilling a clear outline and theme, developing a persuasive argument, enriching it with poignant illustrations, metaphors, practical examples, incisively analyzing heart motives.
See how easy?
And cultural assumptions, making specific application to real life. All of this takes extensive labor.
Well, you made me, tired. Did I read
that? I know. I got tired reading it, right? Why is it worth? Is it worth it?
Yeah, I like I said, I do. I'm trying to encourage you that in the short run, you very often may not see much fruit. You just do not know. You have no idea. I could give you, because I've been doing this for 45 years, I can tell you so many. If Kathy was here, she always remembers the stories better than I do, of people that you thought were getting nowhere, and then. And I do regularly, every so often now, I'll get letters from people who say, do you remember preaching on this in 1981? Do you remember preaching on this? I became a Christian that day. And when it goes back that far, I can hardly remember those times, of course. Mm-hmm. But I do know that I did not feel almost ever that this was a great sermon. Very, very, very rare. I feel like, boy, the Lord was really working, and I just really felt that God was speaking through me. Mm-hmm. That's very rare for me. I've been convinced over the years because I actually have seen the fruit in people's lives, but it's taken a long time. Mm-hmm. So that's my best way of trying to encourage you to say, it's the Word of God that's got the power, not you. The Word of God has its own power. Mm-hmm. Charles Spurgeon is a famous passage where he says, I don't need to defend the Word of God. I don't need to defend a lion. I just have to open the cage. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't need my defense. And I don't need to actually defend the Bible. And he was talking about apologetics. He was saying, if I open the Bible, you'll see the power. I shouldn't have to be sitting here giving you reasons why you should trust the inspiration of the Scripture. But it kind of works beyond that as to say, go ahead, open it up, really do your best and teach the Bible, and you will see people's lives change. Mm-hmm. Very often, not the person you would expect. Very often, the broken down person over here that you thought they really needed, mm-hmm. then some pulled together person over here will come and admit to you that they're not so pulled together, and just do it, and you will see people's lives change because the Word of God has its own power.
It does that.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we now know one thing that your obituary is not going to include. It's not going to include awarded the 2017 Kuiper Prize for Excellence in Reformed Theology and Public Witness. Mm-hmm. But what would you like your obituary to include or to be said about what you accomplished in your life in ministry?
Yeah, I'm not sure. That's a bit of a dangerous question. I can tell you this. My wife and I, you know, at our age, my wife and I, Kathy and I, we, each of us hopes that, I'll put it this way, you know, neither of us wants to, both of us wants to outlive the other person, because mm-hmm. we don't want the other person to have mm-hmm. to deal with life without us.
Yeah.
So we both kind of hope the other person, that we outlive them, because that'll be a pretty hard time. But I do know, I remember reading a place after Lloyd Jones died, that Beth Ann outlived him, and they were at a meeting, a bunch of his friends and were sitting around afterwards, maybe at the funeral or near after a funeral, and they were talking about him. And at one point she said, "The best two things I can say about my husband is he was an evangelist and a man of prayer." So I could be wrong, and I don't even think I've told Kathy about this one, but if when I died and she was around, she could look back at my life and say, "I think he was an evangelist and a man of prayer." I don't know whether she'd say that now. Maybe she would. But if she said that, that would probably be the highest praise I could get from anybody. So, but actually, that's not the sort of thing you put in an obituary. So I don't know. Probably what it'll be in my obituary is my jobs and who has survived me. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I know what you're after, and
yes.
I would say,
what do you want to be remembered for?
Being a man
for?
Of prayer or mm-hmm. being an evangelist is probably the two things that I'm really, not even so much a Bible teacher, probably.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much, Tim Keller, for helping us teach the Bible. Will you thank Tim Keller? You've been listening to Help Me Teach the Bible with Nancy Guthrie, a production of the Gospel Coalition, sponsored by Crossway. Crossway is the not-for-profit publisher of the ESV Bible, Christian Books and Tracts. Learn more about Crossway's gospel-centered resources at crossway.org. Thank you very much.